So over meals the last couple of days, some students, some alums have talked to me about some of the readings for the seminar this afternoon. And I realized I was getting anxious about doing this seminar because the same question kept coming up. Well, why are these like really spiritual essays? Like, why did you pick these? And I realized one of the things that I find difficult about doing these seminars is that the context is too big. The context is, oh, we're all here on this island and we're writing, so now we're gonna talk about like writing things. And so it's this need to put this seminar in a context, this material, is a little problematic. And one reason I picked these essays is because the writing is really, really, really good. So right there, I think that they are exemplars of an elevation of the human. So that would be the broadest term maybe of spiritual. But another thing occurred to me as I was rereading them last night and today. In each of these essays, the narrator is in extremis, right? At the farthest reaches. That's what that Latin means. Or at the point of death. Either literal death. I mean, in the Oliver Sacks, right? He really thinks he's going to die. In the Joanne Beard piece, she does talk about it as being the end of one life and the beginning of another. And most certainly in the Baldwin piece, he sees what's happening with his feelings about his father as being a life or death decision he needs to make. He might need to make it again and again every day in his life about what's going on inside him, but it is life and death for him. So I do think that these essays all have that in common. So then another thing occurred to me today, which I wish we could do, and maybe we'll try to do a little bit of it, and this is going to throw more Latin at you. So I know many of you in here know this term, lectio divina, okay? Divine reading. So the Benedictines claim it as their practice, but it predates them. And it is a way of being with Scripture. Really, the Benedictines, it's the Psalms. It's a way of being with Scripture that is not analytical, but that the reader, the prayer, the meditator puts themselves in the presence of the Word, and by putting themselves in the presence of the Word, they encounter the presence of Christ. And so if we could do something like that with secular literature, that would be great. So I'm going to try to do a little bit of that in talking about these essays. So I'm going to talk about them individually, or you're going to talk about them individually to begin with. And at the end, maybe we'll try to do some contrast and compare if we think that's helpful. So I want to start with, the granddaddy of all essays, basically. I mean, it is, and we came up with a seminar like in February. So sadly, the relevance of this just, it never goes out of date. Let's open up your Notes of a Native Son. What do you think this essay is about? I know it's about a lot of things. Just start. Somebody.
His father's death.
Okay, his father's death, right? On the most literal, overt level. That's the occasion for the essay, right?
It's kind of a leitmotif for the essay.
Right. I
mean, it always comes back.
Right. It's the occasion to start telling you all this stuff. What else? How about going one layer down?
Survival.
Yeah. Survival. Anybody else?
It's a lot about seeing things in himself that he doesn't want to see, like ugly things.
Okay. All right. So that is actually the progress of the essay, right? It's really about the soul's progress in a lot of ways. this essay. Not that he doesn't know these things at the beginning and finds them at the end, which is the way some essays work. He seems to, you know, throughout, he has, there's a huge dialectic in this essay, right? And it comes in all forms. There's a bicameral view. He is somebody who is able to both be the evolved narrator of the essay and the adolescent that he was at the time of his father's death, and in those years predating his father's death that he talks about when he was in New Jersey, and what happened there. So he is kind of, that's part of the dynamism of the essay. He's moving back and forth, right? He's moving back and forth between two states of consciousness in a way, that older evolved narrator and the younger adolescent, the man who has figured some stuff out, the boy who is in an intensely emotional place. So we also have, and that's reflected in the essay itself, right? There's a lot of analysis in here, right? There's a lot of cerebral stuff, and then there is a lot of raw emotion. And that's a very, very interesting mix that he pulls off here. How would you say this is structured? He's got those three parts, you know, one, two, three. What's that about? Anybody have a venture guess? What's the literal structure? What happens here, like from beginning to end? All right, I'm gonna read the beginning. On the 29th of July in 1943, my father died. On the same day, a few hours later, his last child was born. Over a month before this, while all our energies were concentrated in waiting for these events, there had been in Detroit one of the bloodiest race riots of the century. A few hours after my father's funeral, while he lay in state in the Undertaker's Chapel, a race riot broke out in Harlem. On the morning of the 3rd of August, we drove my father to the graveyard through a wilderness of smashed plate glass. The day of my father's funeral had also been my 19th birthday. As we drove him to the graveyard, the spoils of injustice, anarchy, discontent, and hatred were all around us. It seemed to me that God himself had devised to mark my father's end the most sustained and brutally dissonant of codas. And it seemed to me, too, that the violence which rose all about us as my father left the world had been devised as a corrective for the pride of his eldest son. I had declined to believe in that apocalypse which had been central to my father's vision. Very well, life seemed to be saying, here is something that will certainly pass for an apocalypse until the real thing comes along. I had inclined to be contemptuous of my father for the conditions of his life, for the conditions of our lives. When his life had ended, I began to wonder about that life and also, in a new way, to be apprehensive about my own. Okay, so he lays out the whole thing, everything he's going to do. I mean, that's pretty much what's going to happen throughout the rest of the thing. So, how would you describe the persona of this narrator? And this is going to bring us to talking about voice, which is the ultimate important aspect.
He takes time to think.
Okay, this is a contemplative guy. So when I say persona, I'm talking about what is he projecting, his personality of his character that's coming off the page. Okay, contemplative.
There's also that tone of anger. He's upset. Like he's thinking about it, but he doesn't mean he's happy about it.
Okay, so now we come back to that. So the contemplative thing is that rational, analytical, I'm a writer, I'm an intelligent guy, I've read a lot, I'm pretty precocious intellectually, which he lets us know, right? He was a junior preacher. But that doesn't mean that he doesn't have all this viscera, right? This visceral rage. Yeah, so he, what else? What else about his persona?
He's very self-aware and honest about pride.
Right, right. So, you know, part of what any narrative job to do is he's got the camera here and the camera's looking out all the time, right? He's telling you about everything, and the next thing I'm gonna read is his description of his father, this kind of, you know, who he was as a character. And he's pretty eviscerating on his father and on lots of things. I mean, he's got this really cold, steely way of looking at things, but he is totally capable of turning that same gaze on himself, which is, I think, one of the things that makes this really an exceptional experience for the reader. Okay, so I'm gonna read that. This is on 588, it's just the next page. He was, I think, which is a terrific little aside, he was, I think, very handsome. I gather this from photographs and from my own memories of him, dressed in his Sunday best and on his way to preach a sermon somewhere when I was little. Handsome, proud, and ingrown like a toenail, somebody said. But he looked to me as I grew older like pictures I had seen of African tribal chieftains. He really should have been naked, with war paint on and barbaric mementos standing among spears. He could be chilling in the pulpit and indescribably cruel in his personal life, and he was certainly the most bitter man I have ever met. Yet it must be said that there was something else in him, buried in him, which lent him his tremendous power and even a rather crushing charm. It had something to do with his blackness. I think, again, that I think, he was very black. With his blackness and his beauty, and with the fact that he knew that he was black, but did not know that he was beautiful. He claimed to be proud of his blackness, but it had also been the cause of much humiliation, and it had fixed bleak boundaries to his life. All right, so what do you get from that passage? Not just about the father, but about the guy telling you about his father.
I think he starts to realize that in order to kind of evolve as a human, he has to deny who his father was in a way. So he's kind of putting and it's really, really hard for him to do that because he recognizes his father's strength, but he also sees some weakness in his dad, and he has to kind of confront that and how it affects him.
Yeah, and how does he talk about these strengths he thinks maybe his father had, the positive things? I mean, how does that coming out, Alex?
I mean, I don't know if this is what you're getting at, but it sort of rings true to what Sam said, that there's this duality to everything, sort of throughout the whole article, but definitely in this one place where he's talking about like kind of both sides of each thing.
He also, he kind of giveth and taketh away at the same time, right?
Yeah.
When he's, you know, when he's talking about his father.
It's almost like says that part about he is like, I can't find the line like I'm here now, but it's something like he had to admit he was charming. Like he doesn't want to admit these good things. You can tell that he doesn't like him, like that there is this respect and part of that he's like grapple with the good parts.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think he was saying that he's got this natural desire, like any man, to be prideful of himself, to love himself,
yeah,
or to think that he is something special, but that the blackness and the things that went with that hold him back. In other words, there's this level, that there's this thing out there, this discrimination or oppression or whatever out there that will not allow him to feel that way, to rise to the pride that he wants to have about himself.
Right, and actually it's that whole issue of self-hatred that that gets exposed in this essay, but it's a particular thing in the father, you know, for him to see that vulnerability in the father, to come around in some kind of charitable way by the end to see that was in there.
He's also very unapologetically honest about his observations. Whether the observations are correct or not, he's like, but I pictured him as the African boy. He should have been naked. Like, it's just a very honest, this is what he wants to be.
Well, what, that's really interesting. What else about that? Because that's a really, but he looked to me as I grew older like pictures I had seen of African tribal chieftains. He really should have been naked with war paint on and barbaric mementos standing among spears. What's he really saying?
Injustice. There's injustice. That he's not doing that
What about the word barbaric, though? What do you make of that?
Because that was a brute.
Yeah. He's being honest.
I mean, there's some things there that sound quite glorified, and some that he's being quite demeaning of him at the same time. So it's all there, that dialectic throughout this thing, this tension, which is kind of the essence of self-hatred, too. This is on the next page on 589. I do not remember in all those years that one of his children was ever glad to see him come home. From what I was able to gather of his early life, it seemed that his inability to establish contact with other people had always marked him and had been one of the things which had driven him out of New Orleans. There was something in him, therefore, groping and tentative, which was never expressed and which was buried with him. One saw it most clearly when he was facing new people and hoping to impress them, but he never did, not for long. We went from church to smaller and more improbable church. He found himself in less and less demand as a minister, and by the time he died, none of his friends had come to see him for a long time. He had lived and died in an intolerable bitterness of spirit, and it frightened me as we drove him to the graveyard through those unquiet, ruined streets to see how powerful and overflowing this bitterness could be, and to realize that this bitterness now was mine. Any thoughts about that passage there? Yeah, Christine.
It echoes back to that really great two sentences on the previous page where he says he was aware of his blackness but not his beauty, and this is taking it a layer deep and showing that raw insecurity about his own value, but how it played out. I think it takes it that one level deeper. And it's also sort of an address of the birthright. Like, his birthright is bitterness. It's not well, there was nothing left to me in the will, I get
that. Absolutely.
Sadness.
Yeah. And I don't know, I started to count and then I stopped. The word bitter and bitterness is used, I mean, it's, here, right. And that's kind of that's the seed that he's dealing with. That's the seed in the soul that he's got to figure out what he's going to do with that. Okay, I'm just going to move through here and just read some of these passages because I think it's just the way to get in here. So then this is still in that first part, and now he's telling about that year in New Jersey. This is on 592 at the bottom. That year in New Jersey lives in my mind as though it were the year during which, having an unsuspected predilection for it, I first contracted some dread chronic disease, the unfailing symptom of which is a kind of blind fever, a pounding in the skull and fire in the bowels. Once this disease is contracted, one can never be really carefree again, for the fever, without an instant's warning, can recur at any moment. It can wreck more important things than race relations. There is not a Negro alive who does not have this rage in his blood. One has the choice, merely, of living with it consciously or surrendering to it. And as for me, this fever has recurred in me and does and will until the day I die. Let's just take a look at that passage. What, I mean, he's, in the beginning he's 19, and at the end, right, he's flashing forward. Yeah, Ellen.
It's talking about John Hickman's
okay.
And his views, and not being aware of the things that his father was facing, and having that dawn on him at this point on the occasion of his death, or leading up to his death, finally understanding him, how his father became the man that he this bitterness and looking at what's happening around them. And it's very easy to be deceived by your own circumstances when you're living in your own world.
Yeah.
And so that's this fever that he's now realizing that the unsuspecting predilection for it, right? Because it happens and you find yourself maybe 6 months later saying, where did I contract malaria? Oh, yeah. You're going back in time.
That's a great analogy.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, and he says, it, you know, it stays in there. It's like this virus. It's this virus that stays in the body, and yeah. Yeah, that's a great, great analogy. Does somebody else have their hand up if you want to say something? No? Okay, that's a great analogy. So, you know, he has in here, this is just sort of like a crafty thing that I just, partly what I want us to talk about is, this is such a powerful essay. Where does the power come from? Sure, it comes from ideas. It comes from ideas, it comes from language, it comes from the rhetoric, right? This is a son of a preacher. He was a junior preacher himself. The rhetoric is very biblical. The syntax often is. He has elevated language that he uses, right? Elevated language, elevated circumstances. He takes his personal life and he puts it in an elevated political arena in a way. You know, he's conflating what's happening in his personal life. His 19th birthday, his father dying, his mother having her last baby. He chooses, right, to place that in a historical context, too, of what's happening. Of course, it's happening right in his neighborhood. But so he's talking about not just the personal sphere, but the sphere beyond that, and all these layers. It's almost like, anybody ever have that, a three-tiered, like, checker game where you can look through, it's Lucite, and you can play it in a three-dimensional way, and that's what's happening in this essay. But for me, the pivot in this essay has to do with this scene, and it's a scene of action. So he can use all this elevated language, and these great powers of rhetoric, but he would be preaching at you and talking at you. Not that he isn't in places, he is. But he also mixes it up with just, you know, straight out scene. This is on the bottom of 593. I walked for perhaps a block or two until I came to an enormous, glittering, and fashionable restaurant in which I knew not even the intercession of the Virgin would cause me to be served. I pushed through the doors and took the first vacant seat I saw at a table for two and waited. I did not know how long I waited, and I rather wonder until today what I could possibly have looked like. Whatever I looked like, I frightened the waitress who shortly appeared, and the moment she appeared, all of my fury flowed toward her. I hated her for her white face and for her great, astounded, frightened eyes. I felt that if she found a black man so frightening, I would make her fright worthwhile. She did not ask me what I wanted, but repeated as though she had learned it somewhere. We don't serve Negroes here. She did not say it with the blunt, derisive hostility to which I had grown so accustomed, but rather with a note of apology in her face and fear. This made me colder and more murderous than ever. I felt I had to do something with my hands. I wanted her to come close enough for me to get her neck between my hands. So I pretended not to have understood her, hoping to draw her closer. And she did step a very short step closer, with her pencil poised incongruously over her pad, and repeated the formula, "Don't serve Negroes here." Somehow, with the repetition of that phrase, which was already ringing in my head like a thousand bells of a nightmare, I realized that she would never come any closer and that I would have to strike from a distance. There was nothing on the table but an ordinary water mug half full of water, and I picked this up and hurled it with all my strength at her. She ducked, and it missed her and shattered against the mirror behind the bar, and with that sound, my frozen blood abruptly thawed. I returned from wherever I had been. I saw, for the first time, the restaurant, the people with their mouths open, already, as it seemed to me, rising as one man, and I realized what I had done and where I was, and I was frightened. I rose and began running for the door. A round, pot-bellied man grabbed me by the nape of the neck just as I reached the doors and began to beat me about the face. I kicked him and got loose and ran into the streets. My friend whispered, "Run," and I ran. All right, so what's going on in that passage, which I do think the whole essay actually pivots on that. I mean, you can talk about rage, you can talk about anger, you can talk about all those things, but.
Can you have some metaphor, like you've given us this metaphor of this disease, and we're like, okay, the disease is rage, it's anger, right? So you have a bird's eye view, and he takes the reader down and just focuses it. You have a concrete example of the bird's eye view of what I've just given you a metaphor for so that you can understand what blind rage is.
Absolutely.
So you experience it going from large to small.
Absolutely, absolutely. Anybody else?
The embodiment for the reader of what he experienced. It shakes us up in the same way. We feel it and then we come to.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Also, again, this is like a super intellectual guy telling us a lot of like really evolved things and then showing us what it feels like also to be him. So again, we're going back and also he's constantly trying to deal with his rage through his mind. And then it just gets acted out. And I love this word. And with that sound, my frozen blood abruptly thawed. Why is that word frozen in there? That's really interesting to me. Lorenzo.
It goes all the way back to the way he looked at his dad when he was, you know, when he was a kid. Like he said, he's a man. Why is he acting this way? Okay, why doesn't he act like it? Why doesn't he act like he's beautiful? Okay, all right, but that is frozen blood. Okay, that is his inability to be able to see what his dad is really going through.
Okay.
The pain that he's really feeling. The life that he's really living, okay? And his blood, that's actually coming alive. He just woke up. He just came alive. He just realized, oh my God, okay, this is it. That's how I see it.
Okay,
see.
Cool, thank you. Good.
I saw that the switch from like the primitive brain to the linear brain, so it was going to rage or whatever, your frontal cortex shuts down and you go into that like primitive rage.
Okay, so he came back to his higher self when he realized what he did. Okay, yeah, Baron.
Because the shadow of confrontation is there for in every moment of his life, he could almost think he was confronted every moment in his life, because in one sense, he was. But in another sense, he wasn't, and that's the frozen part.
Yeah.
And it took that moment for that to actually break out.
But I also think it brings a coolness to the movie. Like he has this white hot anger and then all of a sudden it's frozen blood.
Yeah, that's it.
There's this coolness to the heat that he sees the people. He recognizes human. Like it's not just great, like human, and he sees himself and he's like, what have I done? I need to exit. I need to get out of here. And it calms his hot anger down.
It's interesting, just that word. You've already, yeah.
As a reader, while reading it, I was frozen during the scene. And so when he was saying that signal to me to thaw out, to calm down, to realize what just happened, to then process it and learn what is okay and what's not okay, it's not always okay to act on your anger, but sometimes it happens. And it kind of showed this human aspect of things that happen throughout our lives. And it was really a wake-up call, like get out of the moment. Get out of your head, get out of this anger, and let's reflect right now.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. Are you going to say something, Muddy?
Yeah, I was going to say, the other thing, too, is, he's actually put himself in a very dangerous situation. He's in a restaurant where he's not even allowed to be served, and he throws a glass at a white waitress. So I think part of that thawing is realizing that he's in a great deal of danger.
Yeah, so I'm really glad you brought that up. Prior to this, we see that he just keeps, kids are taunting him. Everybody makes fun of him because he's not going along with, the Jim Crow laws in New Jersey. And he just keeps showing up again and again and again. And now he's just, he's going to do this thing that really could have fatal consequences for him. Eleanor, are you going to say?
That's why I made that comment. He had been defined. Mm-hmm. Constantly going back, there was one where he kept going back to the same place. he knew they weren't going to serve him. He made it a habit of going back to the same place.
Yeah.
Just to be in their faces about not serving him. Now he's having these reflections and this disease starting to start, occurring to him that perhaps he wasn't understanding his father. And now he's in a situation where, yet again, he's wanting to be confronted, and he starts to thaw and realizes at that moment that he's put himself into a very dangerous position. But he hadn't up to that point. He had just been kind of pushing the envelope.
Absolutely, Anne.
And there isn't such a metaphor. He throws the glass at a mirror.
Interesting, Lorenzo.
I think he, at that point, the intellectualism went away.
Yeah, yeah.
No longer intellectual anymore, okay?
Right.
And now became, all that went away and became the, I've been trying to think of the word to use for it, but I mean, it's like, okay, now I'm going to kiss man. Okay, it's just it.
Yeah.
It's all.
Yeah.
It's done. It's
warrior death.
Exactly.
Right.
Bingo.
Right. I'm going to channel that. Pardon me. Peter.
So Brett Staples' essay, Scattering the Pigeons, it starts out where he's just doing that, then it becomes visceral, and as a result, much more dangerous.
Yeah. Ivaria.
It also hits on a larger point that at some point in our lives, we all face ourselves. And it can be in a moment where you don't expect to see yourself. In my mind, it's almost as if he saw himself in that broken mirror.
And that's how the blood begins to thaw at that moment.
Yeah, so I mean, I think also it's almost like, frozen blood is blood that's not really working to make you a whole person, right? So when he thaws, it's like the feeling comes back everywhere. And, that could have been the end of everything. And this is going to be a struggle that he goes on in the essay to keep saying that, that the real thing that could kill him is his rage, and that's going to be, the enemy that he has to fight. But he kind of comes back to being like a full person in this moment in some way. The blood thaws and it flows back in. Yeah.
How do you take that line of that the rest of the restaurant was rising as one man?
And it's a great line. Somebody else want to speak to that? Yeah, Sam.
It's terrifying. This whole force coming to meet him.
Also, that's his experience. It's a, it might as well be one man. It's this unilateral, force. Yeah, that's always against him, yeah. Yeah, that's a great image, though. Yeah.
I'm not sure if I'm in the right place here, but there seems to me that there's also kind of an element of no matter how much he can, and he's capable of intellectualizing the struggle, the reality is that when he steps out of the door into the streets, he's confronted by every living moment of his life.
Right,
and
right.
You can't think it, but it can't be away from it.
Right. Absolutely. Okay, move on here. I'm just going to read, this is at the bottom of 594, and it's sort of now he comes back and he synopsizes, sums up what's happened here. I cannot get over two facts, both equally difficult for the imagination to grasp, and one was that I could have been murdered. But the other was that I had been ready to commit murder. So this is this dialectic that goes throughout this thing. The thing that's in me, could make me kill somebody else. It also could kill me. I saw nothing very clearly, but I did see this, that my life, my real life, was in danger. And not from anything other people might do, but from the hatred I carried in my own heart. So that's like a huge place to get to from where we just were at in that scene of physical violence. And it's an amazing realization to come to, and it's an amazing thing, I think, to read on the page. I saw nothing very clearly, but I did see this, that my life, my real life, what do you think he means by that?
Because a preacher guy may be his eternal life, not
That's an interesting idea. Okay, eternal life. Yeah, Lauren.
The way he looks at himself, the way he lives with himself every day, the way he has to wake up, and just everything, just being alive.
Right.
Not physically, but just, you know, physiology.
Right. Not just his body, but his, yeah.
Yeah, right.
The whole time he's sort of been dealing in abstracts and like this idea of blackness and barbarianism and beauty, but when it comes down to it, like it's attached to him as an actual person, like he's really threatened. Like it's not just the ideas that are being threatened now, it's himself.
Also, it's his life. It's the one chance he has here on the planet. It's not just his body, it's about his presence being here. That's the thing that could get taken away.
Add to it, it's like kind of like what's going on today. Okay, what's going on with, you know, the Black Lives Matter movement and the police and all this, and every, you know, pretty much a lot of, you know, black fathers and black families, they have this reality that they are citizens of a nation, citizens of a group, but then they see something else going on that they're really trying to figure out, how can I be a citizen and how can I sit up here and deal with this or whatever. So they want to act out and do something, but they realize in order to live their lives, in order to be alive, in order to live their real lives, they can't do that. They can't do that. They have to be part of the larger conversation. So I think that's what I'm seeing in that.
Okay.
There.
Yeah. Thank you. That was an important addition. My real life was in danger, and not from anything other people might do, but from the hatred I carried in my own heart. Okay, I'm just gonna, so then we get to the second part, and he goes to visit his father, which is that terrific scene on the train with his aunt. And again, we have this, he has that whole thing about how he used to think of his aunt one way, and now she made me feel pity and revulsion and fear. It was awful to realize that she no longer caused me to feel affection. That is the most interesting sentence in the world. What's going on in that part, if you remember? You know, they're riding on the train together, and everything this woman does is driving him, you know, crazy. She no longer caused me to feel affection.
Like the obligatory cause. A relative, a face you recognize as a child, is a cause and effect. Like, as long as they're a nice person in general, that child is going to feel affection in reverse, because this is what we do for survival. Like, we want to feel connected and loved. But now he's growing up and he's experiencing the world and he has all this bitterness and these emotions, and he's like, seeing her did not incite that.
Well, and also thought. Partly she's still trying, and that's, I didn't read, I took it out of context a little bit here, but I mean, in my childhood, it had not been so long ago. I had thought her beautiful. She had been quick-witted and quick-moving and very generous with all the children, and each of her visits had been an event. At one time, one of my brothers and myself had thought of running away to live with her. Now she can no longer produce out of her handbag some unexpected and familiar delight. So this is another thing that's going on throughout the essay, right? I mean, his father's funeral is on the day of his 19th birthday. So he is moving across that threshold from childhood to adulthood. And we saw also that even he, at the end of that scene where he throws the mug at the waitress, he assesses that his behavior prior to that had been of a young person. And now he's moving into this other sphere that has to do with the way he's looking at this aunt. And so it's just, and you know, the death of the father is, you know, the ultimate thing that kicks. Going to kick him full scale into adulthood. So then we get to the funeral, which is a really, I think, a remarkable, remarkable part of this essay. It's on 599. There's so much going on here. So I'm just going to read sort of the middle part of that page. This was not the man they had known, but they had scarcely expected to be confronted with him. This was, in a sense, deeper than questions of fact. The man they had not known, and the man they had not known may have been the real one. The real man, whoever he had been, had suffered, and now he was dead. This was all that was sure and all that mattered. Every man in the chapel hoped that when his hour came, he too would be eulogized. which is to say forgiven, and that all of his lapses, greeds, errors, and strayings from the truth would be invested with coherence and looked upon with charity. This was perhaps the last thing human beings could give each other, and it was what they demanded, after all, of the Lord. Only the Lord saw the midnight tears. Only he was present when one of his children, moaning and wringing hands, paced up and down the room. When one slapped one's child in anger, the recoil in the heart reverberated through heaven and became part of the universe. And when the children were hungry and sullen and distrustful, and one watched them daily growing wilder and further away and running headlong into danger, it was the Lord who knew the charged heart, endured as the strap was laid to the backside, the Lord alone who knew what one would have said if one had had, like the Lord, the gift of the living word. It was the Lord who knew of the impossibility every parent in that room faced. How to prepare the child for the day when the child would be despised, and how to create in the child, by what means, a stronger antidote to this poison than one had found for oneself. Yeah. So that's like the whole thing right there, right? If like everybody, you know, every tattoo parlor, that was the only tattoo they could give. Maybe we do a little better here. Yeah. Oh, okay. It is hot. Okay. All right, I'm just going to go to the very end and read the end, and then I'm just going to ask you guys a couple of questions, and we'll move on to the next essay. This is at the bottom of 603. It's just the very end. This was his legacy. Nothing has ever escaped. That bleakly memorable morning, I hated the unbelievable streets and the Negroes and whites who had equally made them that way. But I knew that it was folly, as my father would have said, this bitterness was folly. It was necessary to hold on to the things that mattered. The dead man mattered. The new life mattered. Blackness and whiteness did not matter. To believe that they did was to acquiesce in one's own destruction. Hatred, which could destroy so much, never failed to destroy the man who hated, and this was an immutable law. It began to seem that one would have to hold in the mind forever two ideas which seemed to be in opposition. The first was acceptance, the acceptance totally without rancor of life as it is and men as they are in the light of this idea. It goes without saying that injustice is a commonplace, but this did not mean that one could be complacent. That's really great. It goes from commonplace to complacent. This did not mean that one could be complacent, for the second idea was of equal power, that one must never in one's own life accept these injustices as commonplace, but must fight them with all one's strength. This fight begins, however, in the heart, and it now had been laid to my charge to keep my own heart free of hatred and despair. Okay, so I'm just going to ask you about the experience of reading this. I just want to do a little meta reading. What happens to the reader from the beginning to the end here? What's going on? What happened to you? Forget about the reader. What was this like? Was anybody in here, was this the first time they read it for this seminar? Okay. Somebody wanted to, yeah, Laura.
I think for me, I was just kind of wondering, you know, where he's going to end up. You know, because you got the his side, the son's side, and the father's side. You got the black side, and the white side. And is he going to be able to reconcile all that and find peace? You know, where is he going to land? So.
Thanks, Ellen.
For me, it has to bring with the comments that my colleague made there. This was my first time reading it, and it's the story of my life here, and some of what I've been writing about my relationship with my own father, which is why I said story about survival. There's a lot here that represents essentially how we live and what's happening today.
Absolutely. I mean, this is like essential. bottom of the next page, she says, shaking her head, you're living with this crap? This is another just good detail. It's right after that. He wants me to reassure him that he's strong enough to leave me, I tell her. Elsie won't have fun on his bike ride. And guess what? I'm too tired to. But now I can see him in his dank little apartment, wringing his hands and staring out the windows. In his rickety dresser is the new package of condoms he accidentally showed me last week. Okay, so there again, that's just a detail, a concrete detail that, you know, that's like three or four paragraphs worth of emotion there, just with that detail. So she's very spare in that way. She's very economical. She's using stuff to get at that, all those abstract feelings. All those abstract feelings that, by the way, would make her kind of a victim, right? I mean, this is one of her challenges, I think, as a writer in this piece, is all these things aren't, you know, really going so well for her. And so she's using that kind of, you know, little snarky, ironic tone to distance herself from the, to get a leg up on her victimhood, I think, here. So that tone is really, really important. And also, there's humor in it, right? That's one of the things that's going to offset kind of what's coming, I think. So, and it's, yeah.
Not only, it also really brings home, it's like a punch in the face.
Okay.
Because you turn on that point.
Right. So let's just talk about that for a second. From, she does give you a few, she does flash forward a few times, right? Okay, so we get to, before I go to that, you raised a really good point. It is a punch in the face. So let's talk about sort of the contract that you have with the writer in the beginning, or the narrator, with the narrator. How did you feel about that when you got slapped?
Unlike the Baldwin essay, you're not clear on what the stakes are. And then you think you know what they are, and then you realize, what she does actually hint to it right on the, in the third paragraph.
She does, right.
She says,
they don't know the clicking. So that's the first hint. So it should make you a little uneasy that there's something. I mean, if you're reading attentively, you know that there's something. And then there's a couple more that we start having. I mean, we have the whole, this is on page 11. It's Gang Lu, the doctoral student. Everyone lights up again. Gang Lu stands stiffly, talking to Chris while Bob holds a match to his pipe and puffs fiercely. Nose daggers waft up and out right in my direction. I give him a sugary smile, and he gives me one back. Unimaginable, really, that less than 2 months from now, one of his colleagues from abroad, a woman with delicate bird-like features, will appear at my door to my office and identify herself as a friend of Bob's. When she asks, I take her down the hall to the room with the long table and then to his empty office. I do this without saying anything because there's nothing to say, and she takes it all in with small, serious nods until the moment she sees his blackboard covered with scribbles and arrows and equations. At that point, her face loosens and she starts to cry in long, ragged sobs. An hour later, I go back and the office is empty. When I erase the blackboard finally, I can see where she laid her hands carefully, where the numbers are ghostly and blurred. So, I mean, you read that, and now you know that there's something's going to happen, okay? And that's on page 12. So it's not, you know, you're not completely blindsided, but the tone is certainly not indicative, I don't think, right, of what's going to happen. So now that we sort of have gotten to that, you know, she flash forwards there. Then at the bottom of 12, this other thing, she does this other thing that I want us to talk about. I wish I could say it was speculation. It's not really that. She imagines into the shooter, right? So I want to know what you think about that. I mean, that's the last paragraph on 12, and then she does it again when she actually, we'll talk about that in a minute. Let's talk about this, where she kind of jumps ahead and imagines. Gang Lu looks around the room with expressionless eyes. He's sick of physics and sick of the buffoons who practice it. And then it goes on like that. So what did you think of that, especially once you got to the end?
I think it's
it was a fiction piece. I had to go look it up.
Ah.
And so I was like, wait a minute. And so then I went and researched and I found out what happened because I didn't know about it.
Okay.
So that hit me as a fictional thing because she's sort of imagining.
She does imagine into it. Nobody can know what he was thinking. Just want to know, anybody else have any thoughts about that in here?
Well, I think she's really aware of it all because she works with them and she sees the students' interactions. She sees the competitiveness of the engineering students. So I think she has a good idea of maybe what it was.
Okay, so she's allowed to imagine it.
I think she's allowed to.
Okay.
She's with them enough.
Okay.
This
okay. Yeah, I think that's true. So then, you know, she does this kind of thing. We get to the end of that paragraph. Behind rimmed glasses, he counts with his eyes. In each case, the verdict is clear, not enough that they don't respect him enough. That's at the top of 13. Then there's a double space break. The collie fell down the basement stairs. I don't know if she was disoriented. So what's that? What's that? What? Nope, because later she goes back to work. But what's the effect of that? That, yeah.
Is she kind of doing the same thing that Alan was telling us about last night with the fish tank and you got the dog and the squirrels and she brings up the squirrels at the end. But this is all threaded through here. You know, these objects.
Yeah, but it's not like your logical progression, like she doesn't need this connective material. There's just that, this is non sequitur. You know, the collie fell down the basement stairs.
It's a second distraction. Change the subject to leave you wondering longer.
Okay, okay. Anybody else?
Maybe it's just because we talked about this earlier today, so I'm thinking about that. But I mean, this is a heavy moment, right? Like, this is happening when she brings in the collie. Give the reader a little bit of a break of like, okay, we're going to talk back about this silly collie and this silly squirrel.
Okay, so it's a little stress relief. Very good.
Is it that she's compartmentalizing her emotions and just trying to separate everything out, break it down, and in her mind it's in a format where things are starting to make sense. Not yet, but she wants it to make sense in this way.
Okay. Sam?
She can also deal with the cutting.
Yeah.
It's dying, but she knows what to do. So we'll go downstairs and she moves them and she makes
Yeah, here's things. A smaller tragedy. Yeah.
She can actually provide a solution for it.
Yeah. But actually, in what we know so far, the collie falling down the stairs is actually still the bigger tragedy.
Yeah.
So we don't know. So it's it actually feels like a very steep drop, right? It feels like something terrible is happening.
When it's an escalation. You kind of expect
But there's in that white space is all kinds of emotion, unstated emotion, and that's she does that a lot in here. So I just want you to be aware of that. She makes a lot of this white space of these. These juxtapositions, these weird juxtapositions. Yeah.
Right. And I was wondering, so we've been talking about tone a lot, and her tone, it frustrated me when I was reading this, because it didn't match the subject matter.
Okay.
Like, I'm sitting there waiting for this tone to go deeper and darker, and then it's like, the dog falls down the stairs. Like, that's not the tone you're expecting. And so the subversion, like the subversive tone that she's using, how does that serve her work? It's frustrating.
Okay.
And it doesn't serve for work.
Great point. Somebody want to speak to that? Yeah, what about the tone? What's that? What's she doing there?
I think it says a lot about how we approach tragedy. You can't really wrap your mind around it, so you have to sort of be cavalier or something. Or
yeah, or, you know, she's like this, right? Yeah. She's a little frosty and funny and flippant about it. It's a way, I mean, my sense is that there is so much feeling here. There is so much loss. It is potentially so overwhelming that, and the way you know that it's so overwhelming is because it's pushing up against the very edge of her voice. It's just pushing, and she can't let, if she lets any of it out, it will obliterate her.
You said before I did that, I was going to go back to why the seminar is cybercrime and revertible.
Oh.
That point where it's like choking her. You can't Isaiah.
Right, and also that is actually from Isaiah. God says, cry with a full throat.
Yeah.
And let your voice resound like a shofar. So she needs to get it out. She needs to say it. She needs to tell her story. But yeah.
Would she say that as she's writing this, that she's installing herself?
That's such an interesting idea. Yeah.
It's not about the reader. She's not thinking about the reader. She's thinking more of her writing.
Yeah, I'm gonna. Yeah.
Install myself.
Absolutely.
From writing what's what happened.
That's
next.
Great point, Anne. Okay, now you just raised a whole other interesting question that's going on here. Jen, do you want to say something?
I think that's why we need the extended metaphor of the dog, because I think she's kind of stalling, to steal your word, with how much she cares about her coworkers too. I don't think I would, because of her tone and because of the way she talks, I don't think I would have understood how much she really loved them and loved being around them if I wouldn't have seen her caring for this.
That's really, really, that's a really interesting idea.
I felt like the frustration, which I also felt with her constantly going back to this dog, was actually her container for pain.
Right, right. She uses the dog. Yeah, yeah. I agree. So I'm just going to go back to what Anne said about this whole idea of bearing witness, which I think is also one of the things that I would say makes this kind of a spiritual essay. She's bearing witness to something that happened that was closer in her realm, and her, but she has to tell about what she saw, about what happened. She has to tell about what happened to her, this kind of cataclysm. She talks about it being the end of the first half of her life, okay? It was like a death experience. She is in extremis. And so the job here is to bear witness and tell about it. And I think you're absolutely right that there's some stalling. There's definitely some throat clearing at the beginning, right? And some stalling and all kinds of things. Like, I have to do this thing that I don't maybe really want to do. Sam?
Well, I think because the event itself is so shocking, she can't just go straight into it on our behalf, too. I know Karen said she wasn't really picky about her reader, but in order to show us just how devastating it is, she has to fill the beginning with a lot of kind of everyday things, because these things happen on the day.
Okay.
You get up and catch the bus and make a cup of coffee.
Yeah.
That really, I think, it makes it all the more shocking because her delivery is so, it's not anticipated. You know, she kind of sets us up for the shock that she experienced.
Right. So she's not telling you about something that happened to her. She is giving you the experience of the very thing that happened to her, okay? And that's a huge difference. And she wants you, as much as she can do it, as much as possible, she wants you to feel the thing she felt. She wants you to feel how she felt. And that's has a lot to do with why she made a lot of the decisions she made here about how to tell this story. And part of what's going on is, how do I make you feel this thing that I still don't even understand, this unfathomable thing happened to me, and I want as much as I can to make you experience it along with me. So before we move on to the next one, so did that happen? I mean, what happened to you when you read this?
That one part that you brought up where there is no transition and she goes back to the college on the way to the stairs, I thought, like, there's this huge sense of bewilderment as you read it. And I thought she's so, after reading and thinking about it, and thinking how she went about, wondering how she went about writing, it's two stories she's reconstructing, because it's the story of her living forward. I know that my husband has vanished, my dog is dying.
squirrels on a thing. You know these things mm-hmm. are happening. What she doesn't know is happening is that this huge tragedy is about to happen. So when she goes back and reimagines, she's reconstructing almost what was going on that she wasn't aware
yeah,
of, and it creates that.
Which I think is really such a difficult thing to do. Now she has to, in order to give you the experience she had, she can't really tell you what she already knows. So she has to live her life as she was living it without, you know, too much without the foreknowledge. I mean, that is the way we, and that's so counter to the way we tell stories, right? Because we tell stories where we know the whole thing. She's pretending in a way or giving you that experience, which is the experience of moving through life, which is to not know literally what is going to happen to you in the next sentence, in the next moment.
And in the end, it's so devastating because the people are gone, the coworkers are gone, the dog is gone, the husband is gone, even the woman's squirrels are gone. And it's just, she's there like the Lorax.
Yeah. I think that's true. So before we move on, I just wanted just one thing that I thought was interesting here. So it's on page 15 after that big white space. So here again, she's really imagining into a place she's not. This is the scene of the shooting. She was not at the shooting. She was not in that room. Okay? Did anybody notice what happens? It's 1, 2... It's three paragraphs before we come back. She does something very different. The voice is completely different in those paragraphs. It's just the fact she just tells what happens as if she were in the room, but not her. I mean, it's just a kind of camera. It's like a police report, yeah. And our, you know, trusty girl guide through this world is gone, right? That narrator's not there, that persona's not there. It's all fact. Then we have that white space at the top of 16. The first call comes at 4:00. I'm reading on the bench in the kitchen, 1 foot on a sleeping dog's back. Now we're like back into her perspective. So I just thought that was an interesting, you know, she doesn't choose to stay in the narrator's perspective and just have the news come to her. The phone rang. Anybody have any ideas about why she, I have no idea, so I'm just asking you, anybody know why she made that decision?
What struck me was, I mean, is that it seems like sometimes you go into that moment, it costs you less because you're just going into direct, like, back to
okay, that's interesting. Interesting idea. Tracy?
I think she's letting the reader feel it. And she's saying, okay, now you do it all.
Okay.
You take it on. That emotion, I'm not going to do it again. But here,
I'm dumping it on you. Okay, the really interesting idea. Anne?
It makes the telling of the next part faster because you know all the horrible facts and
Right. We don't have to go through all that information.
It makes you wonder what she's going to learn when, and you know to be devastated on her behalf, and you get to appreciate this moment where she doesn't know yet, but she doesn't.
Oh, yeah. Right. Okay. That's actually makes, right. All of a sudden you're back, now you're protecting her. She's been protecting you all along, giving you little bits of information. Now in a way you're protecting her character. Like it's almost as if you know something she doesn't in that moment when it comes. A really, really, really interesting point. I think that's true. Plus this idea about experience and information. There's information she has to give you literally about what happened. And it takes three paragraphs to do that. But her main concern is with the experience. It's with the emotional experience of what happened. And she separates them. She separates those two things there. So she gets that information out of the way, and then she goes back into that experiential thing. All right, before we move on to the Oliver Sacks, anybody want to just anything I didn't? Yeah, Muddy.
You know, I know I said it was like a punch in the face, and then there's the foreshadowing. We get
Because you're going to get that one person died, right? Something with Bob and Vivi. But you don't get a hint that it was a bigger catastrophe.
That's a great, yeah. That is true. That is true. Yeah.
One thing that New York has wrong, they've had photographs of the deceased in the middle of the article. And so that takes away a lot of what she's
saying. Yeah, I mean, when I first read this, it wasn't in there. And so I went, when I had to find it for you guys for online, then I did notice that. Yeah. Yeah, so that was, yeah.
I think it took her 16 years to write about
it. Yes. Wow. If you look at when this was published and when the event happened, that's a really, really great point. Yeah, thank you. That was a really, really good point.
Rachel, I'm always curious about this when you talk about, like, how did she make decisions? I mean, how much of that do you think was a conscious decision on her part?
Yeah.
That's just like,
because we're here, like, okay. That's what we're talking about, you know? I mean,
okay. I'm always curious.
I know, but you know, the truth is, like, unless you're, like, teaching this stuff or talking about it in that kind of way, I don't really know. Is that even helpful to, like, really discuss that? I don't know. But when I was reading it, I did notice that, you know, that, of course, I got to tell you, I've read this at least 10 times, and it was the first time I noticed that, because usually I'm too taken up with the experience of it to be able to read it in that way. All right, so let's look at the last piece. Really, really, really different. But if the Baldwin was kind of a struggle for moral, spiritual survival, and Beards is kind of a struggle for an emotional survival. This is really like a physical struggle in a lot of ways. I mean, it becomes other things. So, how, you know, Oliver Sacks, what's the persona here? What's this narrator's persona? Because he really does develop himself into quite the character in this piece.
He's an adventurer.
Okay, he's an adventurer.
He's kind of
giddy. That's a great word. He's giddy, right? He talks to himself. He exclaims to himself quite a lot, right? Yeah, there's a lot of exclamation points in here. Right, and he is. I met him once. He, very eccentric is a word you could use, definitely. But he knows it. He's self-aware. I mean, there's a self-mocking thing that goes on here, right? And what do you see right in the beginning that lets you know what he thinks of himself, sort of?
He thinks he's invincible, that nothing's
going
to happen, right?
Right, I mean,
trying to keep going.
Right. I foresaw no particular problems or difficulties. I was as strong as a bull. Well, if you've read the title, you already know there's something ironic here. I was as strong as a bull in the prime, the pride, the high noon of life. I mean, Baldwin has one kind of elevated language. This is another kind of elevated language. I looked forward to the walk with assurance and pleasure. Then at the bottom of the next paragraph, so he you know, sees the sign. To my surprise, there was a fence and a gate at this point, and the gate bore a still more surprising notice, "Beware of the bull," in Norwegian. And for those who might not be able to read the words, a rather droll picture of a man being tossed. That word droll is the word that is the perfect counterpoint to the word giddy. I got there and I thought, a rather droll picture. Could there really be a droll picture of a man being tossed? But that was just, and also that tells you, that one word tells you a lot about the guy who's telling you this whole story, right? I stopped and scrutinized the picture and scratched my head. A bull? ? Up here? ? What would a bull be doing up here? Another question. I not seen even sheep in the pastures and farms down below. Perhaps it was some sort of joke tacked there by the villagers or by some previous hiker with an odd sense of humor. Or perhaps there was a bull summering amid a vast mountain pasture, subsisting on the spare grass and scrubby vegetation. Well, enough of speculation, !! Onward to the top. So he sets himself up, right, as a just almost a borderline buffoon in a way, right? I mean, he's proud. So we get on to the next page. Again, he repeats this onward, upward thing. It's several times in here. This is on page 2. And so I forged ahead, keeping up a brisk pace despite the gradient, blessing my energy and stamina, and especially my strong legs, trained by years of hard exercise and hard lifting in the gym, strong quadriceps muscles in the thighs, strong body, good wind, good stamina. I was grateful to nature for endowing me well, and I drove myself to feats of strength and long swims and long climbs. It was a way of saying thank you to nature and using to the full the good body she had given me. What's that? What's that about? Yes, literally.
Is the sense of exertion that's reflected in the prose as well as the content?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
And like, it's kind of devolved into this like breathy sentence as a piece, as if you're doing something physical.
Yeah, that's definitely true. Yeah, definitely true. So yeah, he's setting himself up.
But it also shows he doesn't take his strength for granted.
Right. Yeah, or maybe. There's a way that he's mocking himself too, even, you know, he has a complicated relationship with himself, a relationship that will actually stand him in really good stead when he finds himself coming down the mountain in a very different manner than he went up, right? So this is at the bottom of that, and this is a great, because the way this whole essay is constructed, it is kind of like, almost like a physical quest or feat sort of situation. This is a description of the bull. I practically trod on what lay before me, an enormous animal sitting in the path, and indeed wholly occupying the path, whose presence had been hidden by the rounded bulk of the rock. It had a huge horned head, a stupendous white body, and an enormous mild milk-white face. It sat unmoved by my appearance, exceedingly calm, except that it turned its vast white face up toward me. And in that moment, it changed before my eyes, becoming transformed from magnificent to utterly monstrous. The huge white face seemed to swell and swell, and the great bulbous eyes became radiant with malignance. The face grew huger and huger all the time until I thought it would blot out the universe. The bull became hideous, hideous beyond belief, hideous in strength, malevolence, and cunning. It seemed now to be stamped with the infernal in every feature. It became first a monster and now the devil. So, okay, so what, now it's, what's going on? I mean, they're still
he's
really...
freaking out.
Okay.
We're feeling it.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so it is a real bull. He really is climbing up a mountain. And now we've got, like, all these metaphors, right? So he's taken himself and made him into kind of a character. And now he's taken his fear, is becoming something else, this kind of heightened thing. But he's also, I think, really... Is that a whole thing about the devil and all that? I mean, as we move on here, something else happens for him that really isn't just physical, okay? And I do that was the one of the reasons I picked this. So then, blind mad panic ensues, and this is on page 3, right before that white space break. To be full of strength and vigor one moment and virtually helpless the next, in the pink and pride of health one moment and a cripple the next, with all one's powers and faculties one moment and without them the next. Such a change, such suddenness is difficult to comprehend, and the mind casts about for explanations. And that's kind of really the crux of the whole thing. And now, because he's a supremely cerebral person, as well as being, you know, full of vim and vigor, or was before this happened, it's his mind that's all he has, right, to really get him back down the mountain. Um, So let's just talk a little bit because his, oh my gosh, okay. His, we'll talk about one thing really quickly because his language is so different from the language in the other two, right?
Yeah.
So who is this guy? And what is he, just his syntax, his diction, his references. Let's just talk about his references. What are some of the references that he makes in here?
Nothing biblical. He's quoting
okay.
Ecclesiastes and then the preacher and the devil. I mean,
yep, okay, definitely, biblical. Definitely. What else?
Yeah. It's Tolstoy.
Okay, we got Tolstoy. He keeps, yeah, yeah. We have a Leibniz, a mathematician and a philosopher. I thought of a dream related by Leibniz. You know, only this guy is like in extremis trying to get down the mountain. But this is the way he helps himself to stay alive, actually. And music, right? Music becomes this huge part of this. He hears music. It was only after chanting the song in a resonant and resounding bass for some time that I suddenly realized that I had forgotten the bull, or more accurately, I had forgotten my fear, partly seeing that it was no longer appropriate, partly that it had been absurd in the first place. I had no room now for this fear or for any other fear because I was filled to the brim with music. And he moves through basically everything he's acquired in his life, right, to help him. So it's his scientific knowledge, right, as a physician, and then he has this. And it was only later that I said to myself, what is this mood? And realized that it was a preparation for death. Let your last thinks all be thanks, as Auden says.